Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Stefan Thurner, and I have the great, great pleasure to announce our first speaker of today, Stuart Kauffman. My job is easy because you all know him. He hardly needs an introduction. You all know that since the 60s, the 1960s, he has invented and contributed many of those concepts in complex systems that are now, right now, getting really popular. He was one of the first to talk about gene regulatory networks already in the 1960s. He invented the NK model. He brought forward concepts like the adjacent possible. He contributed to the movement of origin of life, autocatalytic cycles, etc., etc., etc. You might know classic books from him, like The Origin of Order or At Home at the Universe. And yeah, it's a great pleasure to have Stuart here. Stuart is the founding director of the Institute for Biocomplexity and Informatics at the University of Calgary, and is presently at the Institute of Systems Biology in Seattle. The talk that we will hear from him now centers around the mind-body problem and quantum mechanics, so a topic that's highly intriguing, I think, and let's welcome Stuart.
That was lovely. Thank you. Thank you, brother.
Well, good morning. Can everybody hear me all right? Let me tell you what I want to do in the next 45 minutes. I want to invite us to think together about the role that quantum mechanics may have in the mind-body problem. But I want to do something practical as well. I'm going to be talking about a new state of matter, we believe, with my colleague Gabor Vaté and Samlin Nirenen. Gabor is a quantum physicist in Budapest at Utvish. We call it the poised realm that hovers reversibly between quantum and classical. I'll be describing it to you. As it happens, the three of us have the founding patent on the area, and I almost have control of the patent. And the reason I'm saying this is I want to invite anybody who wants to join in thinking, what can we do with this? And my dream is something like the following. We're in the city where the Dutch East India Company was formed. From that, we've had several hundred years of massive corporations where the workers in the corporation have relatively little stake in it, but people become billionaires. What if we could create something that had an intellectual web of cross-fertilizing patents and intellectual property from which we could create ways of making livings that enhance the livings of lots and lots of people? Nobody has to get enormously wealthy, but it creates jobs and opportunities for many. So I invite you to think about this with me. If you want to reach me, my email is stukauffman, S-T-U-K-A-U-F-F-M-A-N, @gmail.com. And Peter Sloot has kindly agreed 15 minutes ago, I twisted his arm slightly, that if you want to reach me, you can through Peter. See if you can think of useful things to do. I'm 77 almost. I don't care if I get rich at all. I just want to make good things happen, or help make them good happen. So, on to quantum mechanics, mind and body. I'm not a physicist. There are many in the room. Okay. That's obviously the title. And I'm going to begin by saying this. Neurobiologists think that we must make do with classical physics. I think they're wrong. And that's what I want to talk about. So, let's start with Descartes. I think you all know Descartes. He invents analytic geometry, and he invents modern science. In his attempt to maintain the external worldview and our minds, he invents res cogitans, thinking stuff, and res extensa, extended stuff. The second with Newton becomes the Newtonian worldview of classical physics. Res cogitans, thinking stuff. I can doubt anything, but I cannot doubt that I'm doubting. I think, therefore, I am. He's committed to res cogitans. Dies, and we'll watch it die. So it dies with Newton. So we all know Newton, three laws of motion, universal gravitation. Newton just manages to invent brilliantly the differential and the integral calculus. And we all know how it works, but I have to go over it a bit slowly. I have seven billiard balls on a billiard table, and I ask Newton, Isaac, what's going to happen to the balls that are rolling on the table? And he says, look, Kauffman, you're three centuries late, and don't be stupid. Write down my laws of motion in differential equation form among the balls, giving the initial positions and momenta of the balls and the boundary condition of the table, the boundaries of the table. Now integrate my equations and you'll get the trajectories forever of the balls. We put in friction later. What is it to integrate Newton's equations? It's to deduce the consequences of those equations for the motion of the balls. And that's entailment. All men are mortal. Socrates is a man. Therefore, Socrates is mortal. What Newton did is he taught us how to do science by deduction from premises. The premises are the differential equations. Integration is the deduction. He gave us Aristotle's notion of doing science as deduction. With that view, a century later, and Simon-Pierre Laplace, we get the birth of reductionism. The Laplacian demon in the sky, knowing the positions and momenta of all the particles in the universe, can deduce the entire future and the past of the universe. It's a big calculation, but it's in principle doable. That's the birth of reductionism that is with us still today. It's the Pythagorean dream, which I challenged yesterday and when I gave the talk yesterday. I won't today, but I think it stands to be challenged. People thought at the time of Laplace that determinism meant predictability. In 1898 or so, Poincaré showed that for three gravitating objects, one got deterministic chaos. Since you can't measure initial positions with infinite accuracy, you can't predict the long-term behavior of a chaotic system, and that's now perfectly well established. Now, I want to tell you what the stalemate is. Suppose that your mind and brain system, suppose that your brain is a classical physics system, just like the billiard balls. And it's the case then that the current state of your classical physics brain is entirely sufficient for the dynamics of the system for the next state of the brain. It's entirely deterministic, yes? Then there is nothing for mind to do. And worse, there's no way for mind to do it. We've been stuck here in the philosophy of mind since Newton and Descartes. There's nothing for mind to do and no way for mind to do it. Let me call that the stalemate. Stalemate means, well, you know what it means in English. We've been at the stalemate for 350 years. And so we're talking philosophy of mind. There's nothing for this mind to do and no way to do it. Now, the problem is the closure of classical physics. There's no first causes. There's no uncaused events. So the causal closure of classical physics is exactly what gives us the stalemate. Now, is it possible that one could have a conscious classical physics mind? Absolutely. Nothing prevents it. The problem is that mind could not act upon the world. It could witness the world, but it couldn't change the world. It would be a purely epiphenomenal mind. So I'm not saying that consciousness cannot go with a classical physics mind. It's just that it's not what we want. It can't do anything. And then the question is, if the mind can't do anything, why did it evolve? I mean, the most expensive organ in your body is your brain. So the rest of this talk fundamentally is to say we are not stuck with this view, and we're not stuck with this view because of quantum mechanics. To get beyond the view, we have to break the causal closure of classical physics. So there's another problem with classical physics. Most of us, if we're just being naive, think the following. In the next minute, you could decide to stay in your chair, or you could decide this Kauffman talk is ridiculous, I'm leaving, and get up and walk out the door. In the case that you do one or the other, a minute from now, or 2 minutes from now, depending how long it takes you to get out the door, the present would be different. In one case, you're out the door, in the other case, you're sitting in your chair. For choice, in our normal sense of human choice, to be real, it must be the case that the present can have been different. Can have been different is a conditional contrary to fact. In classical physics, it is impossible for the present to be different given the initial and the boundary conditions. It can only be what actually happens. So there's the causal closure of classical physics that dooms us, and then there is the actualism of classical physics that dooms us with respect to any ontological possibility of choice. I'm going to show you that quantum mechanics breaks both of those problems. So that's five. Now the next thing to tell you is, this is not ephemeral. If you'd have said, and I did 10 years ago to physicist friends of mine, but maybe quantum mechanics has something to do at room temperature with brains and bodies. And what they told me is, don't be ridiculous. Decoherence, which I'll get to later, will set in within a femtosecond. You can't have quantum coherent behavior in biology. It turns out that's false, and we've now known it for about 8 years. Light-harvesting molecules are quantum coherent 1,000 times longer than one would have expected for a nanosecond, not a femtosecond. The reason probably has to do with the Poisson realm that I'll tell you about, but anyway, that's an established, clear fact. So many people are now studying light-harvesting molecules, and the other clearest case is bird migration, where some kind of superposition is picking up something about the Earth's magnetic field. We don't know how far quantum biology is going to go. My own bet is that it's a deep part of biology, and I'll try to get to that as we go along. At this stage, all we know is what's well established, what I've just told you. Okay, now, how many people in the room do not know anything about quantum mechanics? So almost everybody knows something about quantum mechanics. Good, so let me go fast. I just have to give you the basic foundations, and I can do it fast. Forgive me for the two people who raised their hands. The room's too full of physicists. All right, here it is. It's a famous two-slit experiment. I've got a wall or a board, and I've cut two slits right next to one another, and behind them is a photographic plate. I cover one of the slits with a little tin plate. I shine a flashlight, say, and it goes through the open left slit, and then I develop the film, and I get a white splotch behind the yellow, the right open slit. Now I change which slit is open, so the left slit is open, and I get a bright spot behind the left slit. That's what we'd expect. Now the magic is if I open two slits, and you all know the answer, I get a light and light and dark pattern on the film emulsion, which is called an interference pattern. That cannot be explained classically. The central mystery of quantum mechanics, said Feynman, is right in this. And furthermore, as you all know, if I tune down the flashlight so one photon comes per hour and accumulate the pattern, I still get an interference pattern. So the stunning thing is whatever is going on that creates this pattern, it's true of a single photon. That's it. Okay, you've got the central mystery now. So the explanation for this is in the Schrodinger equation, which is a linear wave equation, and to get the intuition across to us all, imagine a succession of sea waves approaching a seawall with two slits cut in it, two openings, and propagating through those two openings towards the beach on the far side. Well, you'll get a semicircular set of waves from the left slit and a semicircular set of waves from the right slit. Now imagine walking along the beach and asking where the waves hit. Well, you have concentric waves from the left and the right hole in the seawall, and somewhere on the beach, the crest of one wave coincides with the crest of the other wave from the two slits, and you get a higher crest, or some places a lower valley hits a lower valley, and you get a lower valley. Those correspond to bright spots on the screen. Between them, you get a spot where the crest of one wave meets the valley of another wave, and they annihilate, and you have no wave, and therefore you have a dark spot. So that's fundamentally, mathematically, how you get the interference pattern in the Schrodinger equation. But quantum mechanics is utterly weird, because in quantum mechanics, you can have a superposition of waves. Mathematically, the reason is it's a linear wave equation, and for a linear equation, two solutions have the property that the sums and differences are also solutions to the wave equation. The room is filled with physicists who know this better than I do. And I won't go into this now, but just to say it, because I've thought about it a lot. Superpositions do not obey Aristotle's law of the excluded middle. And I think there's a lot to be made of that, but I won't do it now. I'll tell you a book that I wrote. I wrote a book called Humanity in a Creative Universe, Oxford University Press, out March 1st, 2016, where on the grounds that every Jewish fruit fly geneticist should do something about quantum mechanics. I've done something desperate, and you can find it in there. Anyway, so we have Schrodinger superpositions. Now, von Neumann, in writing about this, talks about two processes. Process two, that's the deterministic evolution of the Schrodinger equation, which gives you the following. Well, and process one. Process one is this utterly mysterious process in quantum mechanics called quantum measurement. So quantum measurement is when the photon hits the film emulsion, it creates a spot. That constitutes quantum measurement. Exactly what constitutes quantum measurement is a matter of some debate, but cases of it are perfectly clear, and that's a perfectly clear case of measurement. The amazing thing in the von Neumann formulation of quantum mechanics, which everybody accepts as mathematically right, is that everybody understands process two. You just integrate Schrodinger's equation, and you get the deterministic evolution of a probability distribution. It's a probability because to get the probability of any particular measurement, you square the height of the Schrodinger wave, called its amplitude, and then by what's called the Born rule, that's the probability that that wave is the one that will be measured upon measurement. Okay, so there's this mysterious thing, process one, measurement in quantum mechanics. There are some interpretations of quantum mechanics in which measurement never happens. The Bohm interpretation is an example. But in Copenhagen, it's part of the center of quantum mechanics, and there's many interpretations of quantum mechanics. But measurement is probably real. Now I want to point out that that counterfactual statements, the present can have been different, are necessary for free will. So there's going to be two things about quantum mechanics that are going to be important for us. One is that there is no known mechanism for measurement. As far as we know, it's acausal. I'll get to that later, but hold it right now. Somehow measurement happens, and whatever the quantum system is, something definite occurs. There's a spot on the screen. Nobody has found a mechanism for measurement, for which of the amplitudes becomes the real one that's measured, since 1927. People have been looking for it. That's tentative evidence that there is no mechanism. And there's a theorem called the strong free will theorem that claims to prove that there is no mechanism for measurement. And then we need counterfactual statements, and I will tell you in a moment about null measurements, which support counterfactual statements. There we are. Next is null measurements. So here's a case in point. You can prepare an electron in a superposition between being in box one and box two, and you then look in box one to see if it's in box one. If it's in box one, it comes to exist in box one. There's no state of the matter until you measure it. If it is not in box one, stunningly enough, it comes to exist in box two. That's true, but it's counterfactual. Nobody looked in box two, but it's come to be in box two. It's like you're coming to be outside the room rather than inside the room. Those experiments have been done. It's called the Baum experiment, and you can find it described very well in The Road to Reality by Roger Penrose, and it's again the Baum experiment, and I invite you to read it. Okay, so that is the ontological requirement for free will. It breaks the actualism of deterministic physics, and quantum mechanics allows us to meet it. Now, why does all this matter? Neurobiologists are absolutely certain that we have to treat the brain as a classical physics device. Well, it is a classical physics device. But that doesn't prevent it from being quantum at the same time. Classical physics can never give us anything but actualism. It's got the stalemate. Quantum mechanics is the foundation, not classical physics. And classical physics doesn't allow it, but quantum physics allows counterfactual statements. And the indeterminism of quantum measurement. There's only a probability for the outcome of each measurement. An electron can be in a superposition of spin up and spin down. And each one has an amplitude, say 60% up and 40% down, and at measurement it becomes either up or down. So it's non-deterministic. So we've broken the determinism of classical physics as well. Now I want to talk about this poised realm. Listen to it with the idea that, is it real? I think it is. And that there's a patent on it that I don't think anybody's going to break. We filed it within 10 weeks of thinking it all up or discovering it or whatever you do when you do it. And I'm inviting us to get together and see what useful we can do with something that may have some intellectual coverage. So here it is. In quantum mechanics, the one used to think about closed quantum systems. A closed quantum system has the property that it preserves all the phase information. So let me define that for all of us. The Schrodinger wave is out there propagating in time and space. At every point, an action variable keeps track of the amplitude of the wave at that point in time and space. Phase information is never lost, and because it's never lost, you get interference patterns on measurement. If you open the quantum system to a quantum environment, so it's now called an open quantum system, the phase information in the quantum system is, and this is critical, lost acausally. There's no causes in this. One says that the quantum variables in the system are being measured by the quantum environment. Hold that in mind. But it's acausal. The phase information is just lost. As the phase information is lost, if you can picture it, I've got this wiggling sea, and each point doesn't know the height that it's at. It's lost phase information. So the interference pattern does, in fact, disappear. It disappears. So if you do the interference experiment with the two slits open, you get two bright spots behind the two slits. So decoherence is absolutely established. It's been done with buckyballs. So you get an interference pattern, and then you can break the interference pattern by decoherence. The time scale of decoherence at body temperature is 10 to the minus 15th seconds, a femtosecond. The stunning thing about the light harvesting molecule is that it's coherent 1,000 times longer. It's coherent for a nanosecond at body temperature or room temperature. There's the beginnings of evidence that this may have something to do with superconductivity, which I'll get to in a moment. So here's the poised realm. Decoherence is absolutely established. But you can get recoherence where the coherence pattern builds up again, or if you will, in the density matrix, the off diagonals go from finite values to nothing, and you just have the main diagonal. Then the off diagonals can grow again, and you have a recoherence of the pattern. There's a theorem for this due to Peter Shor, and it's the basis of quantum error corrections for decohering qubits in quantum computers. If you inject information into the decohering bits, you can get a single qubit to recohere, or you can get a set of them to recohere. So there's theoretical grounds to believe that recoherence is possible. It is the basis of an industry now called quantum error correction for quantum computers, where the aim is to stay coherent. But there's also grounds, and I now have to tell you about the light harvesting molecule that I've mentioned several times. An electron absorbs a photon and goes to an excited state. Very nearby, maybe 30 or 40 angstrom away, there's a reaction center, which if excited will now do photosynthesis. The exciton has to get to the reaction center. If it hopped classically from site to site to site to site, it would be taking a long time compared to being quantum, where because it's in a superposition of states, it can search in parallel all possible paths at once. So that's what's happening. Decoherence lasts this long time. In fact, it decays, but it decays very slowly. So facts. In the normal case, decoherence falls off exponentially, or coherence falls off exponentially fast. In the light harvesting molecule, it falls off as a slow power law. So we've been talking about power laws. It's a power law decay. Nobody knows why. I'm going to tell you why we think it's a power law decay. Well, we can tell us more or less, okay? So that's why it's long-lived. There is grounds to think that in the antenna protein that holds the light harvesting molecules, sound vibrations, phonons, couple to and drive the recoherence of the decohering exciton. So there's experimental evidence that's pretty good for recoherence. So there's a completely good theorem and quite good evidence for recoherence. So one axis of the Poisson realm is the y-axis. I'll draw it from your perspective. There's a y-axis and an x-axis. Here's the y-axis. It's quantum coherent down here, and by decoherence, you become classical for all practical purposes. Namely, the off-diagonals go to zero. By recoherence, you come back down. So you can go up and down over and over and over and over again, like the light harvesting molecule almost certainly does. The x-axis is order, criticality, order, criticality, and chaos. Classically, you can achieve this x-axis, and it's well known, by tuning a family of Hamiltonians from a periodic pendulum where concentric orbits are parallel to one another. So the Lyapunov exponent is zero,
because they neither converge nor diverge. Then you tune the Hamiltonian as you come out the x-axis, and at some point you get a funny-looking Hamiltonian where if you plot now the Lyapunov exponent, it stays zero, and then it kinks upwards and becomes chaotic. So the kink is a second-order phase transition at criticality. So that's absolutely established classically, because that just nailed. The question is what's going on in the quantum world? What is the analog of this criticality? And it turns out it's the metal insulator transition. So down here in the quantum world, here's quantum, here's classical for all practical purpose, order, criticality, then chaos. In the quantum world, criticality corresponds to the metal insulator transition. So it corresponds to a metal where electrons conduct and you have extended wave functions, to insulation where you don't have extended wave functions. It's Anderson localization. And right between, you have these amazing fractal wave functions. They don't spread. They only spread locally because they're fractal in time and space, right at criticality. So the x-axis is real theoretically. I'm now going to tell you that the x-axis is real. So where am I? Okay, so I'm now down to 19 and 20. It turns out you can take an individual molecule and measure where it is on the x-axis. So this is work done by Dennis Salahab at the University of Calgary and Gabor Vate, and I'm on the paper. So I can code it, but the work's theirs. So here's the idea. Any molecule has some set of absorption emission lines. So just get all the absorption emission lines for this molecule. Now, some of the adjacent absorption emission lines are near one another in energy, and some are far away. Plot the distribution of how many adjacent energy levels are nearby and how many are far away. So this is how far apart the energy levels are, and this is how many. In the ordered regime, you get an exponential. So most energy levels are near one another, and then it falls off. In the chaotic regime, from random matrix theory, you get a unimodal distribution with a peak way out to the left at moderate energy levels. And at criticality, there's a unique distribution where the peak is in. I mean, I could write down the equations for this, but drawing it's just as good. The peak has come in. You can look at an individual kind of molecule, okay, and say, are you ordered, critical, or chaotic? And in fact, how close are you? Where exactly are you on the x-axis? Gabor, Dennis, and some of my other colleagues have measured about 1,000 organic molecules, each one. And the results are just stunning. Half of them are ordered. A few are chaotic. Testosterone is, which I think women find appropriate. But almost half of the molecules are critical, a single point on the x-axis with fractal wave functions. This is true. These are new results. They're published now. Why should it be true that half of the organic molecules are critical? Either it's true of all organic molecules or it's true of selected organic molecules. Nobody knows yet, okay? If you took organic molecules from the Murchison meteorite, it's a chondronaceous meteorite, it might be the case that half of them are critical. And that's interesting. Whatever it is, it's interesting. It's fascinating that half of the molecules in you are quantum critical. And they have fractal wave functions. So this means the following. The x-axis is real. It's not just imaginary. It's real. Individual molecules can be mapped on the x-axis, and they can decohere and recohere. Now, this is showing up in a very astonishing way. A bunch of proteins are critical. Silk is not. It's ordered. But a bunch of globular proteins are nicely critical. So they have unique electronic properties. Stuart Lindsay at Arizona State University has taken one molecule, integrin, stretched it out and looked at electrical conductance through it as he applies an increasing voltage. And it looks like integrin is propagating pairs of electrons, not single electrons. Namely, they may be propagating Cooper pairs, which I'm just finding out about. I mean, I'm a fruit fly geneticist. They maybe are propagating Cooper pairs. Namely, there's the hint of superconducting going on in critical proteins, which are in your body. We don't know what this means now, but just think that there's a patent out there that we can build on, and I'm inviting you all, join us. I mean, maybe we can beat the power structure that's killing us in this stupid economy. Okay, they've got these fractal wave functions. Okay, so that's now 22. This is the most far out thing I'm going to tell you experimentally. There's a man named Luca Turin. He claims to have done the following experiment. Apparently he has something of a mixed reputation. He took fruit flies, Drosophila, and he measured by a spin echo experiment that I don't understand, free electrons somehow in the brain of Drosophila, of awake Drosophila and anesthetized Drosophila. The number of free electrons goes up, he claims, in anesthetized Drosophila. I don't know if that's true, but it's certainly a doable experiment and it can be redone. That means that in awake fruit flies, there are fewer free electrons. Well, that's consistent with the idea that they're functioning in Cooper pairs somehow in the awake brain. Doesn't prove it, but can we find out? Yeah. Meanwhile, he selected on fruit flies to be resistant to ether, and he found out that there are fewer free electrons in the awake resistant fruit flies and fewer free ones when they managed to anesthetize them. These are perfectly doable experiments, and I'm going to turn to them again in a minute. Well, I'm getting down there now, and I'm going to end ahead of time, okay? So, just what, if it may be the case, that consciousness is associated with superconducting? It has all the sex appeal of superconducting and, you know, DNA and so on, but we can find out. So, let me go on to the next point. And this is something that a lot of people have suggested. The suggestion is that consciousness is associated with quantum measurement. A lot of people have suggested that. I want to suggest it too. If I have time, I'll tell you about raised potential and raised extension. And when do I need to end? In about 5 minutes? I won't tell you about raised potential and raised extension. All right. I just want to explain non-locality using it. Can we test whether or not measurement has anything to do with consciousness? And the answer is yes. So, one way is the following. There's a man named Dean Radden, and he has published a number of papers with astonishing tentative results. Let me tell them to you. He's doing the two-slit experiment, and he has a person in the same room or a person a continent away trying to alter the intensity of two adjacent bands in the two-slit experiment. This is with a person a continent away, and there's a bunch of computer simulations and so on going on by which the experiments are done. Radden claims the following. He's got a very weak positive result. But it's significant, he claims, to 1 in 100 million. Do I believe it? Of course I don't believe it. Can the experiment be redone? Of course it can be redone. Suppose it were redone by about 1,000 people or parties, and they all got the same result. There's a very weak effect, but it's real. What would we say? We would say that a human being concentrating on trying to make the two adjacent lines become less dissimilar in being light and dark, a continent away, makes it happen. Then somehow it does not work if the patient is not, if the participant is not paying attention, and it doesn't work with robots. Well, he has a kind of consciousness meter. That's just astonishing if it's true. I don't believe it's true. Well, some of you know about non-locality and quantum mechanics, and I wish I had time to tell you about it, but I don't. If the subject were on Mars and the experiment were on Earth, and the same results were found, the time interval is sufficiently great that the results would have to be non-local. And if they're non-local and real, then we can do that experiment in the next 50 years, we can, then mind is quantum mechanical because it's non-local. So I'm telling you experiments that can be done. This isn't just philosophy. They can be done. And I think that Radden's going to succeed, but I don't know he's going to succeed. If so, yes. If so, quantum mind. I'll end on coming back to the fruit fly experiment. Suppose I want to ask whether or not there's something quantum going on in consciousness. And suppose what I do is I take fruit flies, I know they're conscious because I worked on them for 20 years, and you can anesthetize them with ether. Well, do what Luca Turin did, just select on them so that it's easy to anesthetize them. So you've now got a wild-type population that's hard to anesthetize, and a population that goes to sleep on almost no ether for a tenth of a second. Now, sequence their genome. Can you find if there's any mutants? Sure, it's standard genetics. Can you find out for the moment what proteins are mutant. Let's imagine they're proteins. They might not be. They might be RNA molecules, or they might be cis-acting sites, or who knows what. Let it be some proteins. Can we find those proteins? Of course we can find those proteins. Can we find out where in the fly those proteins are? Of course, it's trivial. I mean, just make them radioactive or make them fluorescent and find out where they are. What if they're in synapses? What if they're in, some proteins in cilia? Wherever they are, we can find where they are. Suppose we do that. Then we start to say there's something here that's correlated with consciousness. And now we could ask, is there something quantum mechanical that they fail to do in the mutant protein that they do in the wild-type protein? Well, that's an askable question. It would be nice to have something to look for. Well, one thing to look for just maybe is it the case that the wild-type proteins are conducting Cooper pairs and the mutant proteins aren't? If so, and Luca Turin's experiments were doable over again and held up, and they might, then we begin to have some astonishing results, namely, there's something about Cooper pairs and their propagation in neuroglia or something that we can find out that has something to do with consciousness and it has something to do with measurement. That would be real progress. So look, let me summarize. Neurobiologists want to believe that the brain is a classical device. Well, it is a classical device. Mind you, the physicists in the room can't tell you for sure how we get a classical world. It seems to be here, okay, but you can't get it out of the wave function. Okay, the wave function is in superpositions. So we're worrying why the moon isn't smeared out in its orbit and why it's there if nobody's looking at it. And this is, Einstein was worried about that. But the brain is, if anything's classical, your brain is classical. But that doesn't mean that it's not also quantum mechanical, just like this table is also quantum mechanical. We now know that quantum biology is flourishing. My own hunch is that this poised realm is real. I invite you to consider what can be done with it. My bet is, oh, did I have this up here? Oh, see, I've got this here. Oh, so the funniest, the weirdest thing I'm going to say is 27. We don't know where the classical world comes in. There's something called the quantum Zeno effect. If you take a quantum system in superposition and measure it non-destructively, it falls to a single wave function, which obeys Aristotle's law of the excluded middle. It's that wave function. If you wait, it flowers new amplitudes quadratically in time. But if you remeasure it again, almost certainly you'll catch it in the same wave function. So it is said that if you remeasure it frequently, you'll keep it from changing. That's the quantum Zeno effect. I want to try the idea that we get the classical world from the quantum Zeno effect. And all I need for that is that quantum variables measure one another, which we've already said is in decoherence, where the quantum variable in the system is measured by the quantum environment. It's a non-standard view of quantum measurement, but there's something that supports it. So let's look at it. Quantum variables can measure one another. Fermions exchanging bosons are measuring one another. If so, they should, by the quantum Zeno effect, be able to co-trap one another in a subset of their states. That's a doable experiment. It may be being done right now. There's something called classical emergence. And here's the experiment. I've written it up in my book, and you can find it. I can't remember the authors. They took rubidium atoms at nanokelvin degrees, and it forms a lattice. And by quantum tunneling, they're hopping around all over the place. If you shine a laser on it, as you tune the laser power up, they stop hopping. Why? It's being called emergent classicality, and my bet is it's the quantum Zeno effect. So that's 27. I'll end with D-Wave is a quantum computer being made in Vancouver. It uses decoherence to find good minima on a complex potential surface. Decoherence is kind of like simulated annealing. And D-Wave's really out there, and an old friend of mine is the chief scientist there, Bill McCready. It turns out that in the poise realm, if you watch what happens, you get descending oscillations of decoherence and recoherence. And I'm wondering if that isn't like simulated annealing and putting in pulses of reheating and then cooling and reheating and cooling and reheating and cooling, but reheating less and less and less, if it would find better minima. That's testable. We're going to look at it. We think you can make a new kind of computer. It is not quantum, it's not classical, it's not a subset of classical physics like a Turing machine. It's some sort of trans-Turing system that I think maybe we can build. I think we are such systems. I think it's a technological revolution waiting to happen. And so that's 28, and that's the summary, okay? Why are we stuck with classical physics trying to think about the mind-body problem when we know that quantum mechanics is at the foundation? So I've invited you to think about it, and I again invite you to try to reach me if you wish to through Peter Sloot. I'm not trying to make money. I just want to make interesting things happen. Thank you.
Thank you, Stuart. Fantastic talk. Let's have a couple of questions. Yeah, go to the mic.
Thank you for a very interesting talk, too. I was wondering, could it be that the problem of classical mechanics has to do not so much with physics, but with reductionism? In the sense that if we allow for emergence and downward causation, then we can explain the mind without problem, in the sense that if you have interactions and these interactions can give rise to new laws, which can be represented in terms of information, then you can use classical physics as one description, information as another description. What do you think about that?
Hi, Carlos. You always ask important and good questions. I too hold with downward causation. I don't know if downward causation breaks the stalemate. I think that would require, it's either a deterministic system or not with downward causation. If it's a deterministic system, it's not clear to me how you break the incapacity to get counterfactual statements to be true, which I think we need for free will. But I'm certainly willing to entertain it, and thank you.
Thank you for the great talk, and I really appreciate it. It's really inspiring. But my question is how important for the structure to play the role in forming a mind, whether in a preliminary life form, for example, virus and bacteria, whether they have mind, and how important for the complexity of the mind contributes to forming a mind. Thank you.
So I only understood part of what you said. I understood the word structure. Can you restate your question a little more slowly for me?
Yeah, the structure of the how the particles together to form, to have the emergence of the mind.
The emergence of what?
The mind.
Mind.
Yeah, mind, sorry.
Mind. Okay, so now I can try to answer you. So let's talk about the structure part first. Everybody knows that structure is important. For example, Stuart Lindsay, with this integrin protein, finds that it looks like it's propagating pairs of electrons, but if you stretch it, that's no longer true. It's the same sequence of amino acids, but it's no longer folded the same way, so you change the structure and you change its properties. That's not so surprising. It's surprising, after all, that it may be superconducting in one case and not the other. I haven't told you how to get mind. Nothing in what I've said tells you what consciousness is or what mind is. There's a famous book by, Hey, Catherine. who wrote the philosopher who wrote the book on in 1996? Huh? Yeah, David Chalmers wrote a book on essentially the mind-body problem in 1996. You should read it. He fundamentally says, and I think he's right, no third-party description of the state of affairs of the physical world will give us anything subjective at all. And I think Chalmers is right. Where I come down to is the following. If I get to say that particles measure one another, well, I'll tell you the steps. Structure will matter for this. Suppose that we take Dean Radin's experiments as proved. I don't, but suppose so. We'll know in 40 years. Then we would say that mind has something to do with measurement and that consciousness has something to do with measurement. Hold that. So suppose we really conclude that the human mind has something to do with measurement. But then we say to one another, come on, measurement's happening and humans have only been around for 100,000 years. What else is carrying off measurement? Well, maybe fruit flies can do it. Maybe mice can do it. Maybe trees can do it. Maybe if phonons if fermions and bosons interacting can measure one another, maybe they can carry out measurement, which is what I proposed, and is proposed for decoherence, that the quantum environment measures the quantum variables of the open quantum system. Maybe they do so consciously as well. Now, nothing stops us from that. I see no evidence at all for it. However, if you say that, then the moon is in the same place because its quantum variables are observing itself, and it's not spread out in its orbit. That's nice, because nobody knows why it's not spread out in its orbit, and we also get, by the quantum Zeno effect, a classical world. So if you make that move, it's a kind of a panpsychism, which was done a long time ago by Spinoza in this city. He was one of the first panpsychists, and I am being driven to a panpsychism, and that's okay with me. I don't know what consciousness is, and none of you do either.
Okay, very last question by Ersh, if it's short.
It will be short. You see, ever since William James, people have paid attention to the idea that consciousness is serial. Now,
serial,
yes. Yep. Now, one of the advantages of, for example, quantum computers would be a massive parallelism of an unprecedented nature.
Correct.
So don't you feel that there is a certain tension within your view of the system? So why, it seems to me that if you want to connect consciousness with the quantum world, it might mean that you are losing the real advantage that you might have from this massive parallelism, which then would be not a good thing for consciousness, because that consciousness is serial.
Gotcha. Thanks, Ersh. So I will, if I may, really try to answer that. There is a problem that Francis Crick refers to that may be real. So I need to get it out to get to you, Ersh. So Crick says the following. Suppose that you look at a blue triangle and a yellow square. And he says, suppose that blue, triangle, yellow, and square are processed in anatomically disconnected areas of the brain. I don't know that this is true. Let's assume that Crick is right. Then how does it be the case that blue goes with square and yellow goes with triangle, or whichever way I said it? And people invent the idea of a 40 hertz oscillation. And if blue and triangle come up at the same phase of the oscillation, they're bound together. And if yellow and square come up at the same phase of the oscillation, they're bound together. So that's called a binding problem. Now, the problem with it's the following. Look around the room. How many things do you see at once? You see a unity of a perceptual field that James knew perfectly well about, okay? So I want to use quantum entanglement to try to get the unity of the perceptual field. So I have n entangled variables. I haven't really told you about entanglement yet. And then I want to say that, you see, when you measure one entangled variable, you instantaneously change the wave functions for the other quantum variables. So I want to use that to get essentially the perceptual field now. That's now. I want to get now out of quantum measurement also, because we don't know what now is, and it's just a dimension in general relativity. It's not hard once you've said that measurement CERN gives you qualia to get a succession of them, because measurement is successive in time, if time's real. So you can have both the unity of consciousness and you can have succession. There's one other nice thing that comes from using entanglement. James could never solve what he called the combination problem. He said, suppose you have atoms of consciousness, okay? And those atoms are little bricks. Well, how do you know that a house is a house? From the point of view of the bricks, it's just a pile of bricks. If you can use entanglement, the quantum variables are no longer the same. They're now a single quantum variable of many variables. Okay, it's a single quantum state of many variables. I think it solves James' combination problem. I'm going too fast for it to make sense, but I think. Thank you all.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Andrea Baronchelli. He's assistant professor at the City University of London. His main interest is to understand emerging properties of social and cognitive systems, and in particular, how does consensus in societies emerge in decentralized social systems. His talk today will center exactly on this topic, and please welcome with me Andrea Baronchelli.
Thank you. Thank you. Can you? Hello? Yeah. Many thanks for the introduction, and many thanks to the organizers for the very nice conference. So today I will tell you about the spontaneous emergence of consensus, and I want to start with an email that I received a few days ago while preparing these slides. The subject is good news, and I was receiving this email on September 9, and this email was saying this. This is the second time I'm sending you this email, so I was impolite the first time. And there was a guy who wanted to donate me $32 million. Since I'm in love with science, I'm here with you today, and I didn't reply. But actually, this is a stupid thing, because we immediately recognize that this is spam. Okay. We are very familiar with this phenomenon. Now, I want to draw your attention on how fascinating is the fact that we call this thing spam. Spam has an origin that, I mean, popular science connects with canned meat, popularized by a Monty Python sketch in the 70s, which is super fun. I didn't dare to propose you the video here, but it's, I really strongly suggest that you check it out. And today, if I tell the word spam to you, you immediately think about an email like the one we have seen before. Now, the first transition is very easy to understand somehow. It's the genius of a collective of comedians that took something not too tasty and made it very fun. The second transition is the focus of this talk, because it's something that happened on our social network. Today we agree on this fact. Now let's see how this can happen, but I want, before going there, I want to show you and convince you of something that is obvious in a sense, that consensus of this kind is actually at the root of our social life. Okay, money is purely conventional. Now, the Bitcoin is a big fuss. Why is that? Because people are starting to say, okay, give me some Bitcoin, I'll give you some goods in exchange. Language is an example, as we have seen. Politeness, standards of dress and decorum, like the tie is my pet example, is a crazy piece of garment, but we use it to signal formality somehow. Notion of fairness, and then you can go up till conceptions of right and wrong. And these are all examples, in a sense, of probably the simplest case of social consensus underlying our society, which is social conventions. So what's a social convention? Is an unwritten custom, okay, there is nothing enforcing us to use the word spam, shared through a community. That is, I cannot define my own conventions. It's a convention because we share it all together. And they have a property that is usually, we refer to a convention when it's something that is selected among two or more alternatives. That is, drinking is something we all do, but it's not conventional, right? Having lunch at 12 or at 2 p.m. is conventional and depends on the country you are in. Far from being just fun, these are actually the foundation of social order. Different social scientists have pointed out the importance of norms, which are a higher level convention, in shaping the way we behave. Norms determine our expectation on how others will act, so shape our behavior. Once established, we forget that they are norms, so actually we attach our identity to norms and conventions. And they are not always desirable. Sometimes societies can get stuck in undesirable norms. Now, the big question that since the times of Plato and Aristotle was asked is, where does this consensus come from? Now, the overwhelming literature invokes some kind of centralized authority. This can be a formal authority, which is very simple. Think about the Bible, where Adam gives names to things, and that's it. Or a king that tells you you will drive on the left or on the right. It can be an emerging authority, like social leadership, or can be some kind of a non-formal centralized institution, like something that share global information with all participants. For example, making you aware of the ranking of different conventions in the population. Okay, and then you can have incentives for global coordination. For example, you know, you might be in a situation in which you know that a global consensus would be beneficial. Okay, this is all centralized. Then there is an alternative, radically alternative proposal, which is the spontaneous emergence of consensus. This is a view in which global consensus is the unintended consequence of people trying to agree with each other purely local basis. Now, it is a little bit weird. You are a little bit weird as an audience for this talk, because this sounds very familiar to everybody in complex systems. But outside of this room, this is not so well familiar and not so well accepted. Okay, believe me, I've interacted with various people that, I mean, say this, I mean, this is very strange, particularly people in business schools, for example. And however, let's see what this mechanism of spontaneous emergence that have been proposed. So there is no centralized authority. How can we agree? There is the solution of game theory, classical game theory. They say, well, we are all the same, we are rational, we reflect on the different alternatives, and so we all come up with the best one. And that's how consensus emerges. Schelling in the 60s relaxed this and said, well, actually, you don't need to have a rational reason to go for one convention. There can be some psychological biases that drive us towards the same consensus. And finally, there is the complex system one, which is that it's the collective dynamics of the population that selects the equilibrium. And this is, for example, the replicator dynamics or the naming game that I will go through later. So today I will refer to a strict definition of spontaneous emergence where you have just local interactions and local information, plus in the space of options, you have that all alternatives are equal, so there is no reason to select one or the other, and the dynamics selects the equilibrium. How to test this hypothesis? I will go through a couple of points, experiments and robot experiments that were before my work, and then I will tell you about some work that my collaborators and I have been doing in the last numerous years. Modeling, data science, and a new experiment. So, experiments with human subjects, there are a series of papers that are very interesting. Honestly, they're very well-designed experiments, but they always focus on some higher-order kind of consensus, like, for example, the emergence of compositionality. And so they are very interesting, but for our purposes, not too much, because this is the population size that they have. So two individuals, of course, I mean, it's not trivial to have them agreeing in particular circumstances, but you cannot claim that this is a global emergence of a consensus. And we know that more is different, or at least can be so. Testing it can be very tough. As tough as that Luke Steels in the 90s ran these beautiful experiments called the Tokinets experiments, where we have a population of robots that interact in pairs. They face a shared environment. They interact again in pairs. One of them is the speaker, the other is the hearer. The speaker says one name to refer to one object in the scene. The hearer receives the name and points to the object it thinks the speaker was referring to. Then the speaker points in its turn. If they agree, they reinforce the association between the name and the object. Otherwise, they keep playing. These experiments showed that actually, eventually, these robots develop a simple language. However, the social scientist that's sitting on my back says, but they are robots. Okay, so you have not convinced me. Motivated by meeting Luke Steels together with Vittorio Roleto and Alain Barra and others during my PhD, we defined this naming game model, which is a very simple multi-agent model which reproduces the phenomenology of the robots without many of the complications of the robots. The two key ingredients are memory and complex contagion. And it works in this way. You have a speaker and a hearer. They have a list of names. The speaker selects randomly one name. And there are two possibilities. The hearer knows that name, and in this case, you have a success. And there is a very strong local rule that makes them delete all the competing synonyms and just agreeing locally, and then they will play with other players. In case of failure, the hearer simply stores the name. Now, this is very nice. You have a model which is very simple. You can study it on topology. You can understand networks. But again, the objection is obvious. So, okay, you have a model, but you don't have real data. So in Boston 4 years ago, I teamed up with the group of David Lazar, and we started looking at Twitter. We focused, these are the previous presidential debates, on topical moments like this, the one in which Mitt Romney named Big Bird. Why is this interesting? Because it's something the system cannot predict before, and so this triggers a burst of activity on Twitter with competing hashtags. With a bit of a stretch, you can consider an hashtag as a convention, and you see you have Big Bird, support Big Bird, Occupy Sesame Street, which is where PBS is based. Big Bird is the symbol of PBS, which is the American BBC, if you want. And you see, they were facing the problem that someone was facing, Hiroki Sayama, here on the first day of CCS, where it says, well, competition of hashtags, a persistent dilemma of live tweeting. Now, the model suggests that the system will not be able to support all these competing synonyms, And actually, this is true, and we checked for various cases, that eventually the system will select just one winning synonym. Well, okay, the prediction is loose, and in any case, this is not a closed system. Okay, so again, not enough. At this point, I teamed up with Damon Santola, and we ran a new experiment, which I believe is enough, and I hope to convince you. And so this is the experience that users have in the new experiment. They go online, they see the face of this girl that will stay the same across all the experiment. They have a sense of a population on the left, but this is constant across different conditions. And they know they will play a certain number of rounds. What they have to do, is typing in the name of the girl. Okay, this is all they know. When they are done typing, they are exposed to the name that their partner, but they don't know anything about their partner, gave to the girl. If there is a match, they make a little amount of money, otherwise they lose a little amount of money. And then they play again. The nice thing, of course, is that the partner is not always the same, but actually they are embedded in a social network that we control. Okay, so actually this is how the experiment goes. Subjects arrive, and there are three different conditions: spatial lattice, random network, and homogeneous mixing. So I think this is nice because we have actually purely local coordination. Alternatives are equivalent. We even done control tests with lists, so it should be fine. There is an open-ended set of alternatives. Actually, they can type in somehow. They insult each other. It's quite fun. They have no information about the existence of a population, or in any case, about anything about the population. And they don't even know anything about the identity of their partner. So there are two questions. Do they reach a consensus? And what's the role of the social network? So this is the experimental condition after the first round. This was the one-dimensional coordination number 4 network. And you see, you observe in the graph the emergence of like dominion where the same name is used. The histogram is the cumulative histogram at the end of the experiment. And there is no global consensus in the observation window. And this is the frequency of norms across time. And you see, no norm exceeds 40%. The nice thing is that the naming game model describes this well. Okay, the random graph is somehow similar. You don't have, of course, a concept of space there, so you don't have domains, but you have a clear correlation between neighbors that end up using the same name. Again, in the observation window, they don't reach a consensus. And again, luckily, however, the model wouldn't predict that they reach a consensus. And this is the case of homogeneously mixing population. The guy, this was a picture of a guy, of course, John was winning. And you see, for the first 5 or 6 rounds, the situation is as before. But then at a certain point, one name breaks the symmetry and takes over all the weight. And this is exactly what the model would predict. However, this time is not a model. These are humans playing the game. So I would say that spontaneous consensus this time, I mean, it's experimentally proven, at least in this game. This is a snapshot, a recap snapshot, with the formation of domains on top and the symmetry breaking down. And this somehow mimics something we are familiar with. Regional norms coexist on spatial network. This is a uber famous map of how Americans name sparkling sodas. Actually, soda is already biased, sparkling drinks. And while global consensus emerges in connected networks. And spam, we don't have many synonyms for spam. Okay, there were at the beginning, the older in the room will remember junk mail, junk email, or equivalents, but nowadays we use spam. The nice thing of having a model is that you can say a lot of things extrapolating to larger sizes, and the model would predict that the random graph is in the same universal class, and that the small world property makes the difference. Now, you can tell me, okay, you showed us a consensus with 24 agents in 25 rounds, so on average, everybody interacted with anybody else. Can you do something better? Yeah, we doubled the population. Consensus emerges also with 48 agents, and actually, you have more statistics, and you can do the frequency rank plots, which are the typical for the zip flow. Okay, so the first, the most popular word is ranked first, then the second, then the third. And you see that at the beginning, the three graphs behave in the same way, but then at a certain point, you have a symmetry breaking where the distribution of the homogeneously mixing graph breaks because there is a winner that is getting all the weight. And then we doubled the system again, and we went to 96 individuals. And you see 96 individuals in around 30 rounds again reach a consensus. So this is quite robust, because at this point, everybody interacted on average with 1/3 of the population. And this is replications. Actually, now we have many more replications than this. There is a robustness test in which they had a randomized list for each one of them, so there is no bias initially. And so the network controls the global behavior. You have coarsening on geographical structures. This is very much supported also by the model. You have these domains, and the competition towards a final consensus happens at the frontier between different domains. Okay. And you have symmetry breaking of small world networks. That is, if you want a confused state initially, and then a fluctuation-driven symmetry breaking. So the first take-home message is, we have experimental evidence for the spontaneous emergence of consensus. The social network controls the mechanism of consensus with coarsening or symmetry breaking. And the naming game model captures the observer dynamics well. Now, in the second part of the talk, I want just to touch upon how you can scale up the problem with the next level, which is categories. Okay, so far, well, spam somehow is a code category, but a very easy one, because you have to just to distinguish what... That's not true. It's 60. Okay. because you can distinguish between just spam, what's spam, and what's not spam. The prototypical problem here is colors. Okay, we perceive a large amount of color, this is an estimate, but we have just very few names for them. This is how English speaker would name the colors on this map. This is maximum saturation, and they are ranked in brightness and hue. And you see, they create this domain by simply asking many people. Now, this is very familiar because these are the colors we use. But if you go around and ask other populations, you find out that, for example, the Wobi in Ivory Coast use just 3 color names to cover all the map. Okay. And this seems pretty much random, which would fit with the spontaneous emergence of conventions. However, color problem is much more complex, and you have a universality. That is, behind a surface randomness, if you do statistical tests, but you need many languages, you find that there are some shared properties. Universality is super interesting because it means that the object upon which consensus takes place is not random, or somehow there are some biases driving us toward there. So there are 2 questions. Can we model the spontaneous emergence of categories? And where does the observer's statistical universality come from? So we did a model back in 2008, but we kept working till basically this year, in which there is an environment which is a one-dimensional channel. Individuals mirror that one-dimensional channel. Categories are just segments in this channel, okay? And the only parameter is the just noticeable difference, which is that objects are not closer than the mean. That is, there is a resolution power. Objects that are too close are perceived as the same one. And this is how the model works. Each agent has this set of non-overlapping categories that you see at the bottom. At the beginning, only one category exists. Each category comes with an inventory of words. Okay, because you want to name things that happen in your category. And agents face a scene, which is a certain number of objects or real numbers there. Now, the speaker is the guy who will have to name the topic to draw the hearer's attention towards it. It will discriminate the topics, and this implies the possible creation of new boundaries. Why? Because it wants the topic to be the only object in one category. For example, in this case, A and B are in the same category. There is a creation of a new boundary and the creation of 2 new words, brown and blue. Of course, these are real numbers in the game, but yeah. The speaker says a word, and now the hearer receives a word and faces a scene. And there are 2 possibilities. Either it can identify the object or not. In the first case, it's a failure. The hearer discriminates the objects and adds the speaker's word to the correct category. In the other case, it's a success. Both individuals reduce the inventory associated to the winning category, to the winning word only, like the naming game. Brief recap, in the first case, A and B, the speaker discriminates, will say brown. The hearer says, well, I don't know brown. Okay, what's brown? The hearer can say A is what I call brown, and the hearer will store that. Notice that they don't have access to each other's categories. They just communicate through language, because there is no meaning transfer, that's the thing. In the second case, The speaker says green, doesn't need to discriminate, and the hearer says, wow, there is a name, there is an object there that I would call green, is A. And so they will delete competing names. Now, if you run the simulations with these rules, you see that after a while, you have a sudden jump of the success rate. So after a while, they start understanding each other. Which is the mechanism? Well, the mechanism is a true emerging process of linguistic categories. Imagine an oversimplified setting like this. The speaker says blue. The hearer says, I don't know blue for this object. But after the game, it will store blue. Now, imagine they play a game. This never happens with many agents, but something like that. After the game, this time the hearer would say, ah, no, I would call this blue too. I would prefer green, but blue is fair enough. You have the two adjacent categories, perceptual categories, are now labeled with the same word. So you have a linguistic category. And actually, the number of perceptual categories keeps growing. It's dull. It's a very stupid dynamics. They just keep refining till when they reach their resolution power. But the linguistic categories saturate to a low number. And this is how you have a population. Each bar is an individual. They have their individual perceptual category. And then there is this emerging layer of communication where they are more or less aligned for collective linguistic categories. And you can play with environments, so they tend to refine colors where they're stimulated most, and so on and so forth. But so far, this is random. Okay, this is a stochastic model. You run it multiple times, and you get a random language. So what about human biology? Well, the only parameter that we had was this resolution power of the human eye. Now, what happens if we, instead of using it random, we take it from the human eye, and we plug in the resolution power of the human eye to the hue? I don't have time to go into the details, but if you do that, you can generate many synthetic languages generated by this, who are loosely similar. Actually, you wouldn't distinguish them by the ones that lack this parameter, because this is a very weak parameter. But however, at this point, simulations of the dispersion of the languages you have generated matches the dispersion of human languages. Okay, and actually, there were follow-up experiments from a group in New York that, opened the eyes of monkeys and said that actually the hue is the most receptive discriminating power, so it makes sense to select the hue. So we have local interactions plus a cognitive bias gives you consensus and universal patterns. Or if you want, culture is group specific, gives you a group specific history, which appears to be quite random. But underneath that, we have a shared bias, and this gives us statistical universals. So it's not Chomskyan universal for those of you who are familiar with language. There can be very strong deviations from this, but if you have a large collection of languages, you can detect patterns there. Okay. So the take-home too is that the category game describes the spontaneous emergence of categories, plus plugging the human just noticeable difference, that is a human physiological parameter, in the model, you reproduce empirical data on color naming. And color is prototypical because it's very simple and there are data. But of course, I mean, this is... Last week, there was a paper in PNAS by Morten Christiansen who was showing how, for certain languages, the sounds are shared across language, across 6,000 languages in this case. So coming next, and then I conclude. So, okay, now we kind of have our understanding of how to reach a consensus. Can we influence that? Can we take a population where a consensus exists and steer it? Models suggest we can. Now it's time to run experiments. We have started somehow. The other thing is understanding the role of networks on problem solving. These are experiments we will do with a group in Neorus, and Dan Mostner is here. And of course, it's similar but different. We can think about innovation as a consensus process to a large extent when you don't have a fitness of the innovation. And this is something we are thinking about with Elsar Kaute, who is here. And then, of course, the dream is studying the dynamics in the wild. Observing norms, but this is far-fetched. And these are the many collaborators, Vittorio, Luca, and Alan, and Luca, and Damon for a lot of things, then others too, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Andrea.
No, sir.
Questions? The very end?
Yeah, this was very, very nice. One question I have is that your work shows examples of how a description arises of social behavior in terms of category usage and so forth. Have you looked at all at the way that what are initially descriptive categories can become prescriptive so that a person is excluded from the society if they don't go along with it?
That's a very nice question, and that would, basically you are asking whether we went from conventions to norms. It would be very nice, we haven't yet. But thank you, very good point.
What's the question around here?
Did you think about running a control experiment for the category game, as you did with the naming game? And if so, would you expect any difference from that results? And in particular, what is the effect of the network for the category game?
Okay, that's my personal obsession. So I've thinking, and even this one was initially, we were thinking about that. There are two problems. First, we just reason through categories. So it's very difficult to imagine a setting in which you don't bring your categories from home. Second one, the model suggests, but also if you think about it, categories is by definition, you need many examples and then you need to put them together. So far, I haven't come up with a nice idea that doesn't require a lot of experimental time, because you would need, probably, them to become aware of the environment before starting the categorization process. And this is, I mean, at least in our experiment, after 10 minutes, people like close the browser. It's a tragedy. So, but yes, I thought a lot. Thank you.
In the experiments of Luke Stairs, it was important that within the head of each individual, there was a strong lateral inhibition, right? And I think that's worth saying.
Indeed, in the model that we did, even together with Luke, that's so strong that actually you get rid of everything. The microscopic aspect of the experiment is something we are analyzing now. So I haven't told you anything. It doesn't look to be so strong. I mean, they reuse words that they were around. But so the question is whether.
I think that what I want to say is that at least some lateral inhibition is important. For
absolutely.
That,
yeah? Oh yeah, yeah.
So
yeah.
That people realize this.
Yeah. Absolutely. Thank you. There is one guy there.
It looks as if not only categorization, but also filtering is active in social and cultural clustering of things. I don't want to introduce a row, but in my experience, the English have very few knowledge about Europe. And that they have filtered it out. And that may be the reason for Brexit, that they just have no clue what Europe is.
We can have a beer later on this. Thank you.
Okay, let's thank Andrea again.
Thank you. Thanks.
Here's a present from the organizers.
Oh, wow. Thank you.
It's a great pleasure to introduce our next and last speaker of the morning session, Marta Salis. Pardo. Marta is a physicist by training. She originally was working on spin glasses. She was a postdoc at Northwestern University, and she is now a professor at the Department of Chemical Engineering at the Universidad Rovira y Virgili in Spain. Today, we will learn about her recent work on Bayesian inference on networks, which is a mathematically coherent way of making sense of your data. So please welcome with me Marta Salis Pardo for her talk, Inference on Complex Networks, From Structure to Dynamics.
you have the talk already, so I don't need my computer. Good. So I'm sorry, I changed the title. I changed the title. So, well, first of all, I would like to thank the organizers. This is such a nice venue, and it's an honor and a pleasure to be part of such an amount of distinguished speakers giving great talks. So I apologize, I slightly changed the title of my talk, but when I received the invitation, I was debating whether to talk to you about the most recent things that we've done, but I decided against it. And I sort of, well, wanted to give you an overview of the things that we've been doing in the recent years, meaning recent maybe last 8 years or so, and what we have accomplished since then. And you know, you can go to our webpage to see what we have done more recently. So I wanted to start, I mean, people who have worked on Inference, they already know about this, but I really wanted to start really simple. In the title of my talk, there were two things. Prediction, everybody sort of knows what prediction is, and then inference. So what does inference mean, or at least what I think, you know, would be a good way about thinking about it? So I went to Wikipedia and I just like put here in the slide what it said. So the idea is the following. Inference is just, you know, it says here, you want to deduce properties from, you know, a data set, right? And you will want to extract some logical conclusions from the information that you are given, okay? Very often, the way we think about inference is, you know, I will have a model, I'll have this data, I will look at the distributions and will, if I'm lucky, I will be able to infer the model parameters that best fit my data or things like this. But I wanted to take it a little bit beyond that. I mean, there are so many things we can do with inference, and in particular, we can use this very robust mathematical framework for making predictions about complex systems. And as a matter of fact, I'm going to be talking about how to use inference on when you use the so-called complex networks approach to complex systems. And I will talk about three different problems, or I'll try, I'm allowing, to talk about three different problems that share things in common that might not be evident at the start, but by the end of the talk, I hope to have convinced you that they actually do. So let's see. The first one is about drug interactions. So, you know, we are taking drugs, you know, it's you go over the counter, they give you like acetaminophen or paracetamol, or they give you ibuprofen, or they give you this and that. And, you know, the more drugs you take, the more at risk you are of having some sort of adverse effect. And just to give you an idea of how bad that can be, in the US, and this is data, I think, from 2012, but this data has not changed much since then, 29% of the population, of adult population, aged from 57 to 85 years old, takes at least 5 different prescription medicines a day. And this puts them really they are really at danger of like developing some really serious effect from the combination of drugs they are taking. Okay, so the fact that even like over-the-counter drugs can have very harmful effects on you has like put a lot of stress on pharmaceutical companies who really like have to test their drugs against many other drugs already available to see what kind of secondary effects there could be. So what I'm going to tell you about is that the question that I would like to answer when I'm giving this kind of problem is, can we predict what kind of interaction two drugs are going to have, given the information already available? So this would be problem one that I want to talk to you about. Problem two, whoops. Okay, it's about teamwork. We've all heard about teamwork, right? Teamwork is great. If we work together, we are very diverse, we are going to be able to produce better quality, more innovative ideas. It's going to be awesome, right? But teamwork also has its downsides. So the more people we are working together with, the harder it might become to work with them. And there are communication obstacles, there are all sorts of problems. Some of us might have been involved, for instance, in, say, writing a big European grant, which involves many collaborators. And by the end, that submission date, you typically have very clear the people who you don't want to work anymore because probably they didn't do their job, right? So that probably had a very bad effect on the quality of the work that you delivered. But, well, you didn't have any other way. So the thing is, so can I look at, you know, communication patterns within a team and predict whether there is going to be conflict or not in the future, whether it's going to appear or resolve? So this is going to be my problem too. And problem three, it's sort of like more maybe mundane. So I don't know if you've heard about Netflix. So this is like what typically Netflix will show you, and if you are a user, right, of this like system of like renting movies, like very cheap system of renting movies, then based on the ratings that you are giving, it will tell you, okay, tell me what you liked, and I will tell you what maybe you are interested in watching. And a while ago, Netflix had this contest in which they were giving, I think it was a $10 million prize to the team that would give them an algorithm that would substantially improve on their accuracy at recommending, you know, movies based on what you liked. So the third problem that I will tell you about was like, well, can I use this sort of same of approach that I will be using for team conflict and for drug interaction prediction to predict what movie I like, whether you're going to like a movie or not? Okay, so what do these three problems have in common? So the thing that they have in common is that mathematically they can be seen as sort of the same object. So, and I'm going to describe two situations, right, that are applicable to this problem. So the first one at the top, right, is what we call the missing information problem. So imagine I have, you know, a network, and I have, out of all possible links that there could be between any pair of nodes, I have information over the ones that are, you know, blue or yellow. So I have two possible states for my edges. And then the question is, can I use this information that I know to predict, sort of to infer, what's the state of the other edges that I don't know about? Well, I want to know if they are blue or if they are yellow, right? And the other problem is, given that I have a full observation of my network, okay, at time one, can I predict what the network is going to look like sometime before, at time two, okay? So this is some sort of like future prediction problem. So in the end, these two problems are mathematically equivalent in the sense that what we are interested in computing in both cases is this quantity here. So I want to know what's the probability that a link exists given my observation, okay? That would be an answer to both problems, okay? Now, the thing is that you are only going to be able to do this if the information that you have, your observation, actually has any, is informative about what's going to happen in the future, about the information that you don't know. I mean, this might seem obvious, but if this assumption is not true, then there is nothing you can do doing inference, because if information is irrelevant, then you're not going to be able to make any predictions out of it. And it turns out that for all the systems that I'm going to describe, that seems to be the case, so it's a fairly good assumption, but the assumption is there. So if this doesn't hold, forget it. This is not the way to go. But I mean, very often it does work. Okay, so good. So I'm not going to show a lot of math, but I just wanted to show you this because it's very basic to like the way we are going to do the computations, and otherwise you will think that this comes out from nowhere. So we are interested in computing, as I said, the probability that a leak exists given my observation, which sometimes I will call like some sort of reliability score, how reliable, how sure I am that this link exists given the information that I'm given. And it turns out that it can be computed, and I'm pointing like this with my hand, but you get it. You have to compute these two integrals. The denominator is a normalization constant, so don't worry about it. What I'm interested in is like at the integral at the top. So it has different elements. The first one is like an integration over models, okay? So you have to decide about a set of models that are sort of like going to be good descriptors of your system. Then what you have in here is the probability that a link is given my model, and this is, you know, some model parameter is going to be given to you. And this other thing is something that you might hear about all the time when people are doing inference, which is called likelihood, which is essentially how good a description the model is giving of the data that I have. And the other part over there is something I'm not going to talk about. It's called the prior, but it's not important. So what is clear from here is that you need to decide on what kind of models you are going to assume that are good descriptors of your model, of your system. And when you do this, we sort of like, well, so what I'm going to look at very different systems. So I want to select a kind of model that is general enough to capture the different regularities that could be in these very different networks that could be very different in origin. So I want something that can capture some properties that are general in networks. And one thing that is pretty general is the fact that typically networks have like some sort of large scale structure. So you can divide your network into groups of nodes that sort of summarize the patterns of connections that there are in your network. So, you know, drawing upon this idea, we sort of decided to use a family of models that are called stochastic block models. These are very simple models. They were models that were originally proposed in the social sciences. And the idea is the following. You just have two ingredients. You have nodes that are grouped into groups. And the probability of a pair of nodes being connected only depends on the group assignment of these two nodes. Okay? So we have like a probability connection matrix and the group assignment, and that's it. And I always show this slide with the air transportation network because I think it gives a very good idea of how flexible this model is for describing different patterns of connection. So here I show, you know, a picture of the air transportation network. In here, nodes are cities and they are connected if there is a direct flight between them. And a possible stochastic block model would be a modular one. In here, we have nodes divided in countries so that airports, cities that are within the same country are more likely to be connected than cities that belong to different countries. But there are other ways in which I can try to describe the air transportation network, which would be more like looking at the roles that different airports play. So one can think about the system in which there are hubs or international airports that are very likely to be connected to one another. And then there are these local airports that are probably connected to hubs that are not connected to one another or less often. And that would be, you know, another possible stochastic block model describing this network. So the good thing about these models is, as I say, is general enough. These are very simple models that can certainly be improved, but they are certainly a better option than just consider that my network is modular or it has a core periphery-like structure, because they can just be applied to any of this. Good. Okay, so now, going on to problem one. So, as I said, given, you know, and some observed network of harmful interactions between drugs, can I predict whether a pair of drugs whose interaction has not been tested or has not been reported is going to have a harmful interaction or not? So what we did was the following. So we went to we took two snapshots of a database, of a drug database, one in 2010 and another one in 2012, okay? And we run the following experiment. So we take the snapshot from 2010, and we use our inference methodology to get the scores, so the probability that any link exists in that, given the observation that I'm given. So the probability that a link exists in this case would be the probability that two drugs have a harmful interaction, okay? And I run it on the 2010, and then I look at the 2012 network, right? And I try to see if the scores that I get for the interactions that actually appeared in 2012 are higher than the scores that I get for the edges that did not appear in the subsequent snapshot. So, and we also looked not only at the interactions that appeared, but at the ones that were deleted, because sometimes people, you know, they say that there's a harmful interaction, but actually they made a mistake and there is not. So I'm showing the comparison with two other, like a baseline, meaning like a very naive baseline of what's the most common option. And then what people were doing was basically like making prediction based on the neighboring drugs to the ones that you are querying. And what you see, the green bars are the accuracy that we get with our approach, and the red and blue bars show the accuracy with the other method. So clearly, using this approach, you are doing a much better job at predicting. Now, that's good. But the good thing about this is that you can use it to guide how to go about doing experiments when you put a new drug in the market. So it's not only that you can predict, it's that you can use this for so much more. In particular, what we did was the following thing. We ran this experiment in which, imagine you want to put a new drug in the market, okay? And you know that, well, you know some harmful interaction, only one of this drug, right? And you want to know, in principle, if you knew nothing, you would have to test with every single other drug to see if they have a harmful interaction or not. But there are smarter ways to do that, right? In particular, if you use our inference protocol, then what you can do is the following. So I get all my observation plus this extra edge with the new drug, and then I score all the possible interactions with all other drugs. And I get the top score one, and I go to the lab, I test it, and I see if it's, you know, really a harmful interaction or not. And then I keep iterating this process. And what you find is that, I'm showing just two examples here, is that in order to detect all the interactions that these drugs had, 12, both of them, you only had to do 16 experiments to detect all of them. Or out of 16 experiments, you had already, you know, already found all the possibilities. Because the inference protocol, it's very good really at capturing what it is within the network of drug interaction that it's actually informative about the fact that two drugs have a harmful interaction. So really, I mean, this is a very good example of how like an inference methodology can help you go beyond just model parameter estimation. Now, the next example is teamwork. As I said, can we use the same idea in a completely different field? And that's of team conflict. Right? As I said, stochastic block models are models that were originally thought in the social sciences, but still our methodology was developed thinking about large-scale structures. And in here, typically teams are much smaller. They have like 5, 6, 7 people. It's not something, you know, like the drug interaction network where you have thousands of drugs. So the question is really, can you apply this sort of large-scale methodology and still make sense for a smaller thing? So what we did was we went and we actually took a real data. So we have around 16 teams of more or less 6 people, and they are working on a 9-month project, and we administered 2 surveys, one after 4 months and one at the end of the project. And we were asking them a very simple question. It was like, would you like to work with this person in the future, yes or no? So we were given a yes or no question. And the idea was, if I take the snapshot after the first survey, can I predict what the answers are going to be in the second survey? Okay? So essentially what we have is this. We have a directed network. In here, like a red arrow means node F doesn't want to work with node E in the future, and a blue arrow means that node E does want to work with node F in the future, okay? And then I will make, you know, I will get a score for one of each of these links, and then I will see how it compares with what the actual answers were. And in order to see like how well we are doing in comparison to other like social science methodologies, we compared to the predictions that we're getting from the from structural balance theory. So in structural balance, so the idea is the following. So you have triangles of people, right? And a triangular balance structure is one such that there are an odd number of positive interactions. So say we have 3 nodes, A, B, and C. So if A likes B, B likes C, and C likes A, that's a balance structure. And if A likes B, but B doesn't like C, and A does not like C, then that's a balanced structure as well. And any other structure is not balanced. So the idea in social sciences is that all unbalanced structures will move to balanced structures. And that gives you a way to also like make predictions about how this, you know, network is going to evolve. So what are the results? So we looked at both types of conflict resolution and conflict appearance. And I'm showing here some like the normalized performance. In this case, if you are if your performance is random, the value that you would get is one. Which so the shady area, like the gray shaded area, shows like the non-significant area. You're not doing any better than random. Yeah, and then and what we see here is that structural balance, unfortunately, does not do a very good job at predicting whether conflict is going to be resolved or not in this case, whereas you know the method that we are proposing does. It does significantly improve on that. I mean, it's not perfect by any means, but it does have way more predictive power. And the reason for that is that while you know this sort of like balancing of structures makes sense in a social context, it doesn't capture all the possibilities that there can be. For instance, there are people who everybody wants to work with and people who nobody wants to work with, and these sort of patterns are captured by a stochastic block model but are not captured by this other sort of like social approach. So this was point two. So good, it works for small systems as well. And we move to point three. I'm going to go a little fast because I'm running out of time. So this is like what I said, like can I use this for recommendations? So the recommendation problem is like a similar problem to the ones I've described. The difference is that now you have two types of nodes. So you have people and movies, and people are going to be rating movies from 1 to 5. So you are going to get some observation and you want to predict whether a person is going to like a movie or not that this person has never watched, okay? Oh, good. So what are we getting? Oh, I see there are no labels here. Well, doesn't matter. So what we did is we, like, this recommendation systems are, we didn't invent the problem. It's very old, and there have, like, a plethora of methods to approach this. So we compared our model with other existing approaches, well-performing approaches in the literature to make ratings, to predict ratings. And what we get in here, so our model is the green bar that is the tallest in panel A and the lowest in panel B. All the other models are matrix factorization or item recommendation systems that actually a combination of both was the winner of the Netflix challenge, the 10 million challenge. And what we see is that we do better both in terms of accuracy, which it's not great, it's below 50%, but it's still a very significant improvement over what was there before. And also we do very well in terms that when we don't get the right answer, we are getting really close. So instead of giving a 5, we say it's going to be a 4. Well, that's still good, right? I'm still saying that you are going to like that movie. Or I say you are going to give it a 2 and you actually give it a 1. Well, still you're not going to like it. So it's really working. So essentially it's telling you that, you know, in some way, these sort of models are good at capturing those patterns. The downside of it is if I wanted to make money out of it, I could not do it because this is awfully slow because we are looking, sampling over all, well, over as many block models as we can. And what we did, and I'm going to try to go fast, we tried to speed it up and we introduced what's called like mixed membership. So as I told you before, like stochastic block models, the model that we're using, it's the simplest version. You can do many other things, and a thing that you can do is to go from fixed group assignment of nodes to a probabilistic assignment of nodes. And that gives you the possibility of turning a very slow thing into a very fast thing that scales very well with the observations that you have in your system. And that means that, you know, for the very small data set that I showed you before, they perform equally as well. So I'm talking about the sort of like magenta bar is the stochastic block model one, and the burgundy one is sort of the mixed membership stochastic block model. So they perform equally as well, but the nice thing is that for other like larger databases, I can go and do it. So yeah, maybe we can do some actual recommending based on that. So that's it. I hope that I sort of, you know, convinced you that this is something that it might be worth considering for any kind of problem that you are looking at. So you can use this inference for prediction and just go beyond what you typically do when you look at complex network problems. These models can be extended to, stochastic block models can be extended to capture many other properties of data, to try to look at
layer data, try to introduce metadata information into them. It's really like a, you know, there are so many things that we could do with it, and I hope to be able to tell you about them in the future. So I just want to end thanking the people who collaborated on this, Roger Guimara, with whom we started this 8 years ago, and I hope for many more years, and Noria Rovira, who did the conflict part, and Antonia Godoy and Chris Moore, with whom we collaborated in the recommender part. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Marta. Fantastic. Questions?
People are shy.
It seems to me that this work, which is very impressive, but you've restricted your attention all the while to pairs of things. Have you thought of looking at more things? So, for example, with your drugs, instead of looking at the interaction of pairs of drugs, you could have three drugs would interact differently from the drugs pairwise, and so on.
Yes, that's right. So there are, I have not looked at it personally, but we've thought about it. There are some sort of like people have started to look into it, especially because they are interested in looking not at three combination of three drugs, but you know, looking at like concoctions of drugs and how this. And it can be done. The only thing is that the complexity of the model it becomes little unwieldy. So we have to reformulate maybe how to do it. But yeah, I agree. It's a very, like, people are interested in knowing about that.
Okay.
Hello, thanks for a very nice presentation. If I'm right, the networks you looked at were static, like snapshots in time, is that the case?
For what case?
All the examples you showed, the networks were in temporal space, they were just a snapshot
yes.
in time.
Yes.
Have you looked at networks with temporal trends or these kind of things?
Yes, we have. I mean, I didn't talk about it, but you can sort of like make an extension of these stochastic block models and put them in sort of like a tensorial formulation in which, because you will have three indexes, you don't have like node I interacting with node J, but you have node I interacting with node J at time T,
yeah.
which gives you like an extra index. And yeah, the paper is not out yet, but.
Well, maybe you can't answer this then, but how do they behave then as you go into the future? Do they predict well, or do they very quickly deteriorate under predictions as you go into future?
Well, it depends. I think it depends a lot on the periodicities in your data.
Yeah.
So say you have, for instance, an email communication network. That is rather, it has a very strong periodicity. So it is unlikely that your performance, okay, like 10 years from now, it's going to be bad. But like given a short enough like future time frame, it's going to be quite stable, yeah, I think.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Out of curiosity, do you know how your stochastic block model prediction compares to the performance of the winning teams of the Netflix challenge?
It's better. It's better. It's a mixture of this, but it's better. The only thing is that it's not competitive. I mean, the winning one was like a mixture of things, a crazy thing. But it's slightly better. But we couldn't get the exact same algorithm for comparison, but from the data that they gave, it's slightly better. So it's good. Okay. Good. Thank you.
Okay. Let's thank Marta again. Here's a little present from the audience. Please don't go away. Please all remain seated. I have a very important announcement to make. Yeah, if you thought you were off the hook and could go for coffee, that was wrong. We will have the ceremony awards of the Complex System Society now. And for this reason, I would ask the president of the society to come on stage. And please welcome with me Yamir Moreno.
Thank you very much. I promise this will be really quick, but this is an important part of our activities as a society. As you know, we implemented like 2 years ago three awards of the society, the Service Award, the Junior Scientific Award, and the Senior Scientific Award. We have been, this is the third edition of the award, so I will just take 10 minutes out of the coffee break to announce who are the winners of this year. So, Alain.
Yes, so I'm very pleased to announce the Service Award of this year, so of the third edition. The Service Award goes to someone who has been one of the founders of the society, so basically one of the persons responsible for our presence here. And he has not only been the founder, but he has also acted as president and as member of the executive committee until last year. And this is basically the reason why he gets the award only at the third edition, because he was still in the executive committee. So for obvious reasons, since the executive committee decides who gets the awards, we did not give it to him yet. So I'm very pleased to give this year awards to one of the father of this society, Paul Bourgine.
So it's a great honor, of course. In 2005, according to the decision of the General Assembly of 2004 in Torino, in an hotel of London, Mina Teicher, Jeff Johnson and I, we created our learning society, its statutes and bylaws. And at this time, it was a European Complex System Society. And next year, at the Council in Oxford, the Council self-decides, it was not in the agenda, self-decide to remove the mention of European. And we become immediately an international learning society. And it was a great moment of enthusiasm. And we can all be very enthusiastic and proud with our great conference each year in great places, now all around the world. Congratulations to all those that have organized the annual conference, and also to those that design and manage the website. All of that is really full of life. I want finally to tell you some words about the Complex System Digital Campus as a unit in UNESCO, where Mina Teicher, Jeff and I are deeply involved. UniTwin means twinning universities. When a new science emerges, UNESCO likes that a network between 2 and 5 universities coordinates the launching of this new science for all the world. But we have 2 orders of magnitude more universities, and we are hoping 1 order of magnitude more to go beyond 1,000 universities in the world. The UniTwin is a perfect place for any of you for launching an e-team having its own collaborative e-studio, organizing its own regular e-seminar, its own e-conference, for writing papers 24 hours, with its international teams all around the world, for proposing courses on MOOCs, and for being member of the scientific committee, or for being member of the scientific committee of the E-team, with a division of work between senior and junior. All of that will be available rapidly on the new CSDC website. Again, it's a great honor and a great pleasure, especially amongst so many friends who are responsible for our so successful collective adventure. Thanks so much again.
So it's my great honor now here to to give the prize to the two young researchers who won the Junior Scientific Award. I would like to call them one at a time. I believe they all deserve the stage alone for a while. So the first one is, in alphabetical order, at the pleasure to tell to Manlio De Domenico that he was awarded his prize and his contribution. He made a number of important contributions. I read some of his papers, then I read all his CV, and there are even more. It's a fantastic job what he did. He worked mostly in the field of multilayer networks. He made a number of important contributions, mostly for me, this is what I like most, is tensorial representation of them, so it's a great pleasure give to him, to Manlio, this prize, fully deserved. Congratulations.
Please. Okay, so thank you, Guido, for the very nice introduction. Well, it's a bit scary from this side of the room. So let me thank the Complex Systems Society for this award. I'm very honored to get it, actually, because I am a young researcher in this field, but really it's just 4 or 5 years almost that I work in this business. And I really like the community that is here, from senior to junior people, because they are very friendly and they provide a very nice and exciting environment, at least to grow from scientifically point of view. So I will just let you know a bit about my story, because it's very weird. I am a physicist by training. I got my PhD in Catania, University of Catania in Sicily. And I was working on astroparticle physics. Yes, nothing to deal with complex system stuff. But in parallel, I was working more for fun with Professor Vito Latora, that is there. At that time, he was leading the Laboratory for Complex Systems, and a lot of guys that are part of these communities were there. It was a very nice laboratory, a very nice place where to go ahead on this business. And he was able to convince me to leave that physics, astroparticle physics, and to move on complex systems. Actually, I moved abroad. After that, I went to Birmingham, University of Birmingham in UK for 1 year, and I started to work on human mobility and complex networks, of course, information diffusion on complex networks. And after that, I have been lucky, because I moved to another great place, that is Spain. In Spain, I met very nice and strong groups working on complex systems. And in particular, I went to work in the group of Alex Arenas in the Alepsis lab in Tarragona, in Catalonia. Yeah, that was a very nice experience. It's still a nice experience, because I am there, still working with those guys, and they are like a family for me. And I was so happy to stay there that I built my family. I had a child there. So just to conclude, I am very happy to stay in this community and to have given some contribution to this physics. and I think I was very lucky to meet during my career Professor Latorre and Professor Arenas, because they are very good mentors, probably two of the most brilliant and best mentors that one young researcher can meet. So thank you very much.
And so now it's a great pleasure to invite the second in alphabetical order, and it's Emilio Ferrara that is here. He's really one of the rising stars in this field of computational social science. I work myself a little bit in that. You need several skills. So you got all of them in an exceptional way. So,
thank you so
great
much.
Pleasure.
Thank you. Thank you so much to Guido for the nice introduction and the nice words. It's really a tremendous honor for me to be awarded this prize by the Complexity and Complex System Society. As many of you know, I am a computer scientist by training, therefore it was a surprise, but it's also flattering and humbling to be awarded by a community mostly of physicists. I will be very, very brief. I don't want to keep anyone from, you know, the coffee. There are three groups of people that I would like to thank, because without their help, their constant presence in my life, in my professional life, I wouldn't be here today. Very, very briefly, my alma mater group from Sicily, from University of Messina. I'm really grateful for all the work they did to provide me with all the opportunities for the future. And then my adoptive, professionally speaking, home, Indiana University in Bloomington, in particular, Alessandro Flammini, Phil Menzer, Filippo Radicchi. I'm so glad that I spent a few years there. We did a tremendous job. And finally, my newfound home in California, which looks a little bit like Sicily, so I'm very happy about that, and University of Southern California, and in particular, Aram Galstian and Christina Lehrman. Just to conclude, this is the first real important award that I received based on recognition of my work, and I want to really dedicate it to the people who supported all my decisions in the last several years, which is my family and my wife. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So, and finally, another scientific award. It's this time given the Senior Scientific Award. This year recipient of the Senior Scientific Award have made a long-standing scientific career in the field of geography, urban modeling, dynamical systems as in complexity, and he has pioneered the ideas of cities as complex systems, as well as for his leading role in the conformation of science of city that combines a wide spectrum of disciplines. The award is given, and it's my pleasure to invite to take the award to someone that I think all of you know. It's Professor Michael Bacci.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay, well, thanks very much for this award. I should say that perhaps I'm an interloper in this field. I was trained 50 years ago in the University of Manchester in architecture and planning. And of course, the discipline or the subject area that you're trained in, you're always a prisoner, really, of those ideas. And you're also a prisoner of the time in which you're trained. The 1960s was a relatively optimistic time in Britain that we thought we could change the world, thought we could plan the world, essentially. And of course, planning and cities are very different now from what they were then. But in fact, over the years, I've sort of persevered with these ideas, and then suddenly, within the last 10 years or so, large numbers of people who were really never interested in cities as phenomena have been attracted to the field. So this is a very dynamic area at the present time. Many of the sessions here are illustrative of what's happening in terms of cities, etc. So anyway, thank you to all of the people who supported me, and indeed my nominees, Maxi San Miguel, Jose Ramasco and Marta Gonzalez. I don't know whether you're supposed to know who the nominees and supporters are. I never know with these sorts of awards, but nevertheless, in this time of transparency, this is the case. I also was taken by when Paul was awarded the award a few minutes ago by him saying that the title of the Complex Systems Society was changed from the European Complex Systems Society some 5 or 8 years or so ago. And so it's now the Complex Systems Society. I like to think that that is sort of a good prediction of Brexit in some sense. It's a good job that it's no longer called the European Systems Society. Anyway, Brexit, of course, has entered our conversations in many different ways, and we're yet to see what it really means in a sense. But I do think that it will not lead to any lesser cooperation in some sense in interdisciplinary forums such as this one. Anyway, I'm going to stop at that point. I know you're all very anxious for coffee. In fact, let me advertise the fact that this afternoon in the final session, I'm going to give a short talk about cities and complexity and complex systems. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. You can go to coffee.